Hi there. It's great to be with you. I wonder if you have at home Christmas gifts that you're unsure about. Those socks from Aunt Bessie, that jumper from your cousin. I've got a few hidden away at the back of drawers, and I'm sure you do as well. Amidst all the seasonal delight, there are those gifts which come unwanted. Some you can pass off to a distant friend or work colleague, hoping they don't get back to the giver. But others sit lurking at the back of drawers, reminding us about the giver, our thoughts and emotions surrounding them. At present, we rightly stay home to save lives. Our horizons have become reduced. Our view is forced inward, perhaps even to that drawer with that unwanted jumper. Like some gifts, isolation is for itself, and most of us, unasked for. It has come as a nuisance for some, and even a death sentence for others. Wherever we are, it certainly feels far from being a gift. But to hear some people, isolation seemed full of promise. Time to read, to do the garden, to start making bread, to work more efficiently, to contact loved ones online, to become your best self. But then the reality of loneliness, dodgy internet connections, worry about a lack of food or loss of employment, let alone trying to homeschool children or different ages in one room whilst trying to work from home. And the list goes on and on. For some of us, it may still have that first promise. And if that's you, I'm thankful for your joy and hope that you can share it with others. But for many, it is in fact the unwanted, unbidden, unasked for gift. So what are we to make of this? How are we as people of faith to live well and to bless the communities around us? Well, some Christians have not held back in proclaiming they know the bigger spiritual picture. The questions of why are all natural and understandable. Why has this happened? What does COVID-19 mean? Is God really present? But if, like me, you're spending more time online, it's all too easy to come across those saying it's God's judgment on a particular people, or God's vengeance for a particular lifestyle, or even worse. Do remember, the scriptures tell us it's not ours to know such things, and it certainly isn't ours to judge. Divine love is never expressed as personal hate. Whatever we do know, around the world, we are now connected by being separated. We are all in it together, but apart. In the Christian Bible, we find an account of people suffering together. Their world has been shattered when sent not into isolation, but equally painful far away from their home and culture into exile. Even as they returned, they found hope, but also threats on every side. In a book with a name as ancient as its word, Zechariah, we find this in chapter 4, verse 10. The people should not think that the small things are unimportant. Amidst great promises of a new hope and a future, all the people could see was one crazy old man marking out a space on the ground where a new city and home might be built. He had a few tools, but nothing else. And some looked back to their former city and temple and couldn't believe that this old man and small start would get anywhere at all. But God's voice was clear. Maybe sometimes we hear it better in the old translation. Remember this? Don't despise the day of small things. Don't think the small things are unimportant. So amidst all the pain of our current isolation, I think God is still with us and speaking to us, to me and to you. When we're reduced to one space, let's not despise it, but maybe look for the gift within it. As the people of Zechariah and Ezra's time, thousands of years ago, looked at that small start, they did find hope and promise. If God was with us in this small thing, how much more will he be with us in what's to come? On Friday, Pope Francis gave one of his extraordinary addresses, Urbi et Orbi, to the city and to the world. It was extraordinary as well to watch. A single chair in an entirely empty St. Peter's Square. Rain pouring down, the gloom enveloping the divine space. And surrounded by the horrors of the situation in Italy, Francis spoke of our time as being that of evening, darkness, a distressing void. This seemed to me to be the embodiment of futile small things. An old man, alone, sitting on a single chair, speaking apparently to no one. What kind of gift is this? Speaking about Jesus calming the storm, Francis powerfully reminded us of his words, "Why are you afraid?" In the midst of the tempest, Francis says, "God reawakens us." For me, this single man on his lone chair was a powerful reminder of how in Christ we remain connected, that hope is present in every small space, that Jesus knew isolation yet drew close to his Father, and in that prayer reaches out in love to you and to me, to the city and the world. Jesus knew what it meant to be restricted and limited. Most of the gospel stories come from intimate home settings. Of course, most of us remember the big set pieces, the stuff of great hymns and fiery sermons and Sunday school things. But most of Jesus' life and ministry was conducted in a very small space, not 30 miles across, and in domestic places and houses. And ultimately on the cross, his cry of desolation means he is at the heart of our present isolation. "Why have you forsaken me?" he cries. No easy answers, but an absolute presence of love. So as we are forced to be small, static and still, let us embrace whatever kind of gift this time is, for God is here with you and me. This week, the BBC interviewed Joe, a young man from Manchester, and asked, "How are you coping in isolation?" He replied, "I'm not someone that does great in my own company," but went on to say he was finding ways to adjust. And it really struck me when he ended echoing the words of scripture by saying, "Find the small things that give you joy throughout the day." That's my advice. So in the new patterns of the day, of the small space, I want to invite you to join me, Zachariah, Pope Francis, and perhaps even Joe from Manchester, in asking God to reawaken those joys for us of prayer, contentment, and service. For myself, I want to start noticing things again with joy, perhaps even that unwanted Christmas gift or other items of memory or meaning. We only moved house 2 weeks ago, so we've got boxes everywhere, giving me a chance every minute, but you'll have your own way of seeing and noticing. Who gave it to me? Could I call them? How might I pray for them? Why do I feel about them the way I do? Perhaps I'll notice more of my own thoughts or emotions and bring them to God in prayer. The Psalms remind us that can be anything from despair to elation, sorrow to joy. And perhaps I'll try to connect in different ways to my neighbours, especially the ones I don't yet know, or light a candle in my window at 7 p.m. along with many others. These can be done with whoever we have in our household. In my experience, often children and seniors have a much greater capacity than those of us caught up in the rush of life. So let them lead the way. My friends, don't be condemned by what you can't do or are not, but rejoice in what you can and who you are, made in God's image, no matter how small that may seem. As those ancient people looked around, the prophet Zechariah had a powerful reminder why exile would not be the last word and why there was hope. And for us, why isolation will not be the final word. He reminded them a few verses earlier that it was not by human might, nor by human power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. However isolated you are, don't be afraid. That same Spirit of Jesus is with us, teaching us not to despise the small things we have at present. For even there, we will find what church really is, what community can truly be, and what kind of strange gift this time is for each of us. It probably will not be easy, but it will be worth it. Who knows? You might even come to love that jumper after all, or even better, the person who sent it to you in the first place. Please know our prayers for you, and thank you for your prayers for us and for the whole world. May God's gift of grace be yours now and in the days ahead. Do take care, and we look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.